If you've got a socket set and a screwdriver, then you'll be fine. Just remember to keep all the nuts and bolts together, otherwise you may be in deep trouble when they go back on.
Now, I've got a bit of work to do still. I've got to undo a whole load of screws on the back of the roof here, but to get at them, I have to put the roof up. So I'll see you later. Now, that really is topless motoring. Oh, now, it's a real shame that you guys at home can't smell how rancid this interior is. Basically, all the water from the roof has been running onto the carpet. It's been sitting there, mildew's growing, mould is growing. It is disgusting. Now, the only way to get rid of this is actually to take the carpets out and throw them away. But to get at them, I have to take out the seats. Now, they're held on with some runners, and they're held on, in turn, by two bolts at the back and two bolts at the front. So that is what I'm going to start with. Well, these seats not only smell past it, they actually look past it too. So I'm going to have to replace the whole of the interior. Now, ordinarily, that would be quite an expensive thing, but because there are thousands of these things out there, chances are we should be able to get something from a salvage yard. In the meantime, this is for the bin. As with any well-made car, the carpets aren't just chucked in, they're actually held down by some special plastic parts. Now, the three main components to this are the centre console, and you have two sill top covers on either side. I've got to be very careful when I'm removing these, because if I break them, of course, I can't put them back in. Now, with the last screw undone, I'm not just going to wrench this off, because, of course, there's some cables for the electric windows to remove. So I'll just ease it out carefully, and then pull off these connectors here. And there we have it, one centre console. Well, goodbye mildew, goodbye mould.
With the carpets out, I'm pretty chuffed because the floor pan and internal panels are all rust-free. It seems that the water was only surface deep.
The seats in the carpet are now history, which means I can get to work on the rusty A-pillar. Now, the thing is, that rust can be quite extensive, so to make sure everything's going to be okay, I need to remove the front wings and also the windscreen. Now, it's a bonded windscreen, which means it's stuck in with a special glue, which needs specialist equipment to remove. So I've enlisted the help of a professional to make my life a little bit easier.
The mobile windscreen removal man, Martin, charged me just £75 for this, but I'll have to pay him £75 to put it back in as well. Worth remembering for the budget.
Well, now the windscreen's off, I actually get on with the wings. And this may seem rather a strange thing to do, to actually pop up the light, but I need to get access to all the bolts that hold the wings on, so now I can start.
I guess I'm lucky because these wings are bolted, not welded to the frame. Even so, it's a fiddly job, and you need to take off the wheels and inner plastic wings to get decent access to all the nuts and bolts.
And there we have it, one wing. Now, I didn't think it was going to be too hard, but it did take a while because I had a lot of bolts and screws to undo. But now I've done all this side, I get to do the other side. With the wings off the car, I can now see the full extent of this rust damage. And the really good news is that under the wings, it's all okay. And also, on the passenger side, it's also pretty good. The real horrible rot is down here on the A-pillar of the driver's side and also under the scuttle. Now, to be able to get at that, I need to take the bonnet off. So just when I thought I'd got rid of the socket set, I'm going to need to use it again. I'm going to repair this rust in two different ways. For the lighter rot just down here, I'm actually going to grind it down with a wire brush and then paint over with a special rust treatment which converts the rust into a firm material I can put some filler on and then paint it. For this really, really rather serious rot here, where it's actually eaten away the whole of the A-pillar, I'm going to have to put in some new metal, weld it in place, bit of filler, and then some paint, and hopefully everything will be sorted. Now, of course, I'm going to use a grinder. So first of all, goggles, and earmuffs, as usual. Now, this is a bit of metal I've just cut from the car, and you can see it's very rusty and well worth removing from the car. But I need to replace that with some steel. Here we are. And, of course, you can see quite clearly they're different sizes. So what I need to do is make a template.
The best way to make a template is to trim down a bit of card. It's easier to sort out the problems on paper than in steel. Form the card around the A-pillar until you're 100% sure that it's the right size and shape. Then lay the template on the steel and mark around it with a heavy pencil line.
All I have to do now is cut out the metal itself, put the bends in and then pop it into place and weld it into position.
Now that sounded really easy, didn't it? Well, the truth is this kind of work requires a lot of skill and experience, but the only way you're ever going to get that is by giving it a go yourself. My tip is to practice on something throwaway before you start having a go at your prized Bentley. You'll need a decent vise, strong clamps and a piece of heavy iron to help manipulate the softer steel.
Well, that looks pretty good now. So the next job is welding, and it may distort just a little bit, so any sort of discrepancies I can normally tap back into shape with a hammer. Now you can see I've got some clamps holding this in place, but it's only just so I get the first couple of tacks in. But while I'm talking about tacking, it makes sense to do this very, very slowly. Put too much heat into the panel, it'll distort and then it'll look all ripply, and there'll be even more filler I have to put in later on.
I'm just welding the metal into place. Don't worry about being too neat here, as you can always grind away the waste.
Well, that's some pretty good distortion-free welding, so all I have to do now is smooth it off with a grinder. All of the welding ground down, I'm now at the stage where I can smooth out these lumps and bumps with a smear of filler. But before I can do that, I need to treat this rust. And I have this magical liquid here, which completely chemically transforms the rust and stops it dead. It takes about 3 hours to dry, so all I have to do is paint it on. There you go, after 3 hours, there's no more rust. But my next concern is this shiny paint here is going to stop the filler from adhering, so I have to prepare it by sanding it down.
Filler-wise, use a golf ball of paste to a pea size of hardener. Mix them up well until the filler is one blended colour, and then spread thinly.
It's been about a quarter of an hour and the filler's hard now, so I can now go over it with a sanding pad and actually get it all nice and flat. I'm happy that all the repair work's done here, but I'm going to have to paint this with a bit of primer before I can go over the top coat. But I am actually going to paint the whole of the windscreen frame with the blue paint, because it'd be very difficult to try and feather it in. So before I can do any of that, I need to sort of rough up the surface, give it a key with effectively a scouring pad. Now, as always, a good paint finish is determined by all the preparation. So I'm going to wipe the panels with a bit of pre-paint to get rid of any grime, dirt, and grease. I've covered all the repaired areas with primer, and now I'm going to flat this off, basically smooth it out, with some 800 wet and dry paper and a dab of water. And that way, it'll be lovely for my top coat. Now this is an aerosol can of our top coat. I got the code from the car, it was DU, which apparently transfers to Mariner Blue. So, let's see what happens. Now to be fair, this has been quite a laborious process, when you think all I've been doing is repairing the rust on these A-pillars. But when you look at the finished job, it is almost immaculate. And once I've actually cleaned all the panels and polished them all up and got all the colours back together, it's going to be nearly good as new.
Remember our smelly old black interior? Well, here's our fragrant new one. Well, new to us anyway.
Now that is a whole load fresher than that disgusting interior I've already had to rip out of the Mazda. But as you can probably tell, it's not brand new, and that's because that would send us way over budget. But I did manage to find these in a specialist breaker's yard, and I got a bargain. This pair of seats, £120, the front carpet, £20, and the rear carpet, £15. So I've got a complete interior for £155.
The interior trim is going back in, no trouble at all. My meticulous storing of the nuts and bolts has certainly paid off, but it is still a sea of black plastic in here. Mike promised me he'd drop into an MX5 specialist to see if there's anything he can do to lift the tone a little. So time to catch up with our budget-blowing hero.
Click here to subscribe.